Let me ask you a question. Where is it you get your anime information from? I'm not talking the latest headlines like show announcements and that general stuff. I'm talking like real in-depth behind the scenes stuff. Do you get it from websites like Anime News Network? Do you get it from well-known respected YouTubers like Joey the Anime Man or Mother's Basement, for example? Do you follow the Twitter feeds of individual creators, companies, studios, actors? Or maybe you're old-fashioned and you like to go looking through old print. Print like magazines, to be exact. Oh, Newtype magazine. Newtype has been running since 1985, published by Kadokawa Shoten and featuring articles and columns from just about all facets of the industry. You have interviews, art, and even manga. There are schedules of upcoming TV shows and DVD releases, although now I presume Blu-ray releases, maybe even streaming, I don't know. And since 2011, it's also had its own anime awards. I guess they operate on Tokyo Anime Fest logic, more like they act as meritorious awards to individuals rather than specific titles, save for a couple categories anyway. Now, Newtype also had an English version known as Newtype USA. It was actually published by ADV Manga, which was an arm of the former ADV Films, and it ran from November 2002 through February 2008, after which it ceased publication for unknown reasons. There was a brief replacement magazine known as Peak, which launched in April of 2008. It was intended to be a bit more broad in scope as opposed to Newtype. But Peak didn't last very long. It ceased publication just 3 months and 4 issues in. While the US magazine was published by ADV, it still featured stories and ads and other things about anime from other companies, not just the ADV Films catalog. But I think the manga inserts might have been exclusively ADV, but I don't have enough magazines to say one way or the other. In fact, most of the ones I have just feature the same manga. The USA editions featured pretty much the same content as the Japanese editions, translated articles for the US market, but they also had a few unique things. They had columns and articles, for one, by non-Japanese writers. They also had posters, cutouts, centerfold spreads, and as I mentioned, featured some serialized manga. And a lot of them also came with a DVD insert that would feature anywhere from 1 to 3 individual anime episodes to sample.
Now, I never did become a subscriber to Newtype USA. However, I did buy an edition when the magazine was still in circulation.
I remember, it was May 2006. I was out on a high school field trip down in the city. I had some free time, so I was able to shop around, and, well, I found myself at a Virgin Electronics store. And there it was, a magazine with anime on the cover, so I just had to buy it.
Yeah, how do you like that? You go on a field trip to learn about civics and government and shit, but instead, you go buy a weeby otaku magazine. That's what being a teenager was all about. Well, it's been 15 years since that day that I bought that first magazine of mine. Now, I thought about this video quite a while ago. I thought it'd be kind of fun to maybe look at the DVD that came with my edition, talk about some of the anime on it, but instead, I had a new idea. I thought it'd be fun to go find a bunch of back editions and talk about them, rifle through them, look at them, show you some of the stuff that they included all the way back then.
Now, there's a lot of issues floating around out there. I even saw a listing where I could buy a whole bunch just for a few hundred dollars. Yikes! I'm really not that eager to spend that much and have that many old magazines laying around, so instead I decided to find ones that would suit my own interests, going for editions that would probably have articles on my favorite anime of the era or just other things I might be interested in. And as it so happens, I actually found several. That's amazing. A lot of the shows I liked didn't really become household names or staples of anime in the West. Hell, these are shows and creators often neglected by the internet community at large today, even by sites like Anime News Network.
Now, as you saw, I've got a whole bunch of these to look at and talk about with you, and I decided to rifle through them kind of randomly to keep the video interesting and fun. But let's start with the one that got me going, the one that inspired this video to kick off in the first place, the June 2006 edition. Specifically, June 6, 2006. Yeah, that's right. This magazine is 666, it's possessed by the devil. sexy anime girls are the links to Satan, damn it.
Feature cover story is actually on the Gainax series, This Ugly Yet Beautiful World. It featured an interview with the two dubbing leads, Jessica Boone and Cynthia Martinez. Pretty cool, I guess, if you're into dubs or you watched this particular anime. As for me, I only saw a handful of episodes of the series myself. I guess it was okay, but I don't know, it's kind of weird. For me, the real highlight of the edition is the article on .hack Roots, which actually hit US Cartoon Network in the fall of that year. Compared to another edition I have, though, this .hack story is not nearly in-depth as the others. It's a really short blurb, but it's more of a generic sneak preview about the anime. It has this short basic timeline of the content before it, a little on the upcoming GU trilogy of games, and that's really it. After that, we have a creator profile on Mitsuru Hongo, specifically for the upcoming Immortal Grand Prix series. Hongo actually cites Outlaw Star as a major influence in IGPX. It's actually nice that the article mentions the original Micro series that preceded it, even if it's just a short passing mention. Oh mama, indeed, it's Witchblade. Angel Dust Neo. But I did actually read one volume of this manga years ago. I thought it was kind of dull, to be honest. Here's an ad for Ghost Stories. You too could enjoy how wacky ADV Films was, really, back then. I think pretty much everybody knows about that dub. Ah, see, this is my kind of magazine. You just got ads for anime, manga, and merch. It's not like other magazines that are packed with cigarette ads, car ads, prescription drug ads, and so much other bullshit. Let me tell you, the days before smartphones, things were really terrible. Hey, here's an ad for Kingdom Hearts. I'm assuming it would be Kingdom Hearts 2. That probably would have been the newest one at this time. Here we have some character art for Eureka 7. It's the kind you would probably see as an anime's ready to come out. So it's your basic production sketch art. Here's a preview on the Fullmetal Alchemist movie, which hit theaters that year. Exciting as it sounds to have an FMA preview, it's really your basic plot summary. It's a lot like the .hack article I just mentioned. Adult Swim in 2006 for all you night owls out there. Our voice actor profile is on Yui Aragaki, and our cosplayer spot is on, a spot on Genshiken in Elemental Gilead. If the airships are rockin', don't come a-knockin'. Really? Alright, this issue is from April 4th, 2005, and its cover story is on Gundam Seed. As for the feature story, it seems to be talking about the latter half of Seed. I like this quote here, we've seen Kira cry so many times. We have, it's not a bad sentiment to have, that is Kira. But nevertheless, Kira is a great hero, who rises to the challenge and horrors of the war in Seed. That's what makes the anime so great. For the article itself, I'm sad to say it's more of a summation of the story up to that point. There's really nothing that interesting or unique about it. I was hoping for some creator interviews, but I imagine I'd have to find a much earlier edition for that, given this is so late into the run. But there's so much But as I said, after that we have features on Elfin Lead, Scrapped Princess, Fullmetal Panic Famufu, and Gunslinger Girl. This one's a lesser-known Sunrise anime that I've never really heard of, Overman King Gainer. Maybe it's loved among Sunrise fans. I'm not really a big mech fan, so I can't say for sure. Never heard of it. It seems like it was made in association with Capcom. But again, all these are your basic plot synopsis. There's nothing really amazing about them that you couldn't find online at the time either. But we do have a pretty nice creator profile on FMA director Seiji Mushishima. He actually thinks FMA is his biggest influence. And naturally, a lot of the spot is about his process of making the FMA anime. 2005 was the year Naruto made its debut on US TV, along with IGPX and, well, you probably remember that Bo show. I don't even think I said that right. There's too many bows in it, damn it. Here's a short column mentioning the live-action Kiki's Delivery Service. I have an update. I didn't actually read the Kiki story carefully, because I knew there was a live-action Kiki, but the one I was thinking of at the time of recording that was the 2014 movie, so long after this publication came out. As it turns out, this was a planned Disney movie that never materialized. I thought that was kind of interesting, and I wish I'd mentioned it. So back to the video. Below that is about the launch of Shoujo Beat. Shoujo Beat was a magazine launched by Viz, no doubt to try and catch the female demographic with shoujo-oriented manga. You could call it their sort of female answer to Shonen Jump. And if you know Viz, They hit it really big with Shonen Jump, both in manga and anime. Shoujo Beat ran till 2009 when Viz officially cancelled it, citing economic issues at the time, though a couple staffers felt it was more the result of unrealistic sales expectations, hoping they'd see the same numbers as Shonen Jump. Honestly, both reasons seem pretty plausible. Obviously, the economy in 09 was pretty bad, and executives are really stupid like that. Though I guess the label lives on. My most recent Yona of the Dawn manga still has it brandished. Happy anniversary! It's 20 years of Newtype. The manga feature is, whatever that is. Here's an ad for the Anime Network. Remember that? Neither do I. Okay, I do. Damn, the centerfold is Madlax! See, this is what made magazines so awesome. Who else would give the centerfold to Madlax? Here we have more letters to the editor. This one wondered if Naruto would be licensed. Well, I guess he got some good news, didn't he? This one complains about the slow process of getting anime in the UK. The editor says it's the result of the slow process of converting it to the Queen's English. Man, who'd have thought adding extra O's and U's would be so complicated? In the fan art, we have this nice sketch of Edward Elric. Oh yeah, I remember this crazy rumor that anime was going to be banned in the USA by the president. This was 2005, so we'd be still at the middle of the Bush administration. But yeah, it's a hoax. A hoax that I think found new life again. I recall hearing the same thing in the early years of the Trump administration. Don't worry guys, it's not going to happen. This month in anime history. 15 years prior, we had Grave of the Fireflies and My Neighbor Totoro get released. I think a lot of people forget Grave was doubled up with Totoro because of how heavy it was. And yeah, while Grave was a critical success, it wasn't a very profitable film. Totoro, on the other hand, was a huge success on both ends. This is a list of current TV ratings for anime in Japan. The shows are listed alphabetically, so you gotta really pay attention to what the numbers say. But in terms of the numbers, it looks like One Piece was the real topper. No surprise there. Let's look at the monthly DVD sales, and Shrek is at number 2? Number 1 and 2! Well, that's a shocker! Oh hey, Kotoko's Resubmility is charted at number 4 in CD sales. I love that song. May 5th, 2007, the feature story is about Tsubasa Chronicle. But I have to gripe about the cover using the manga art. Now, that'd be fine if the feature was on the manga itself or Clamp in general, but this is about the anime. Shouldn't it feature, you know, the art of the anime? I already hate the way I only ever find manga art when I search for images. The article itself, of course, starts with your basic plot summary of the story, character profiles, the like, usual stuff. But here's a design pro tip for all you listeners and watchers out here. Don't use dark font colors on a dark background. The text is already obscenely tiny. Does it need to be harder to read? Let's get to the good part of this feature though, getting into some interviews with the cast and crew. The article asks the subjects 3 questions, their biggest challenge, their impressions on the series, and to leave a message for the readers. Of course, they talked with the whole main cast, but they even talked to Kari Nezuka, the voice of Chi, who appeared only once, maybe twice in the first series. As well as Yuko Kaida, the voice of Soma. Again, she only appeared like maybe 2 times. I guess you could say the same about Maya Sakamoto here, but at least it was easier to believe that Tomoya would have a greater role in the story. Spoiler alert, she did. Not to mention, she also did the ending theme song. And haven't you heard? She's Sakamoto. I actually love Shinichiro Miki's interview. His is probably the shortest of all of them. He says it wasn't hard, he thinks the show's good, and he did his best. I guess he's just a man of few words. On the staff side, you have the usual suspects in a feature like this. You have the director, Koichi Mashimo, the composer, Yuki Kajura, and the writer, Hiroyuki Kawasaki. Awesome stuff already, but what really impresses me is they actually talked to the art director, director of photography, the color designer, and the character designer, Minako Shiba. Rest in peace, by the way, she sadly passed away this year. Others they talked with include the assistant director and later on co-director, Hiroshi Morioka, the concept artists, and the sound director. Damn, they really went all out with this one. A lot of times interviews like this will naturally talk to the cast, the director, maybe the producer and character artist, but this one they really dug deep. It's wonderful they reached all around, throughout the production cycle. And reading these was super interesting, but also made me kind of sad with so many being so excited and thrilled to work on a show like this, and knowing the bitter hindsight of how fans hate this series.
And I mean hate. Some people hated it so much, they wished actual harm on the people who made it. Now, I know, a lot of it's just hyperbolic internet comments, no one's really being that serious. And of course, all of these were made long before the tragedy at Kyoto Animation. But goddamn.
Toru Nakano, the sound director, said this will be the shows that defines his career. Fuck. I guess at least most people like the acting, so there's that going for him at least. Morioka said he took one of Shaoran's catchphrases to heart and really applied it to the work on this show. Shiba-san is pretty sweet. You really get her excitement and enthusiasm here. And here we have another Gundam Seed story. This one's a joint interview of the voices behind Kira and Atherin. For Kira's voice, Hoshi, it seemed like a lot of his co-stars gave him a hard time while recording. Talk about your enforced method acting. Here's a preview for The Melancholy of Haruhi Suzumiya. Like Tsubasa Chronicle, this is actually seeing its US release around this time, and the article actually has an interview with Tatsuya Ishihara. Speaking more of Clamp, here's a preview of the Kobato manga. Here's a brief spot on 5 cm per second. The article mentions it was an amalgamation of several ideas Shinkai had brainstormed. I guess that explains the really unusual structure of the movie. Oh, Bokurano. Now, some of you may actually know this as the anime that was homaged to in Madoka Magica. It has a sort of similar concept, with this series being a darker take on children's mecha shows. Deals with the devil, all that kind of stuff. From the creators of Haruhi comes Lucky Star. At least it's appropriate. The centerfold is 0091. Letters to the editor and fan art. Oh hey, it's Midna! I guess this person doesn't seem to be a yaoi fan. Oh, here's some art of Dothack Roots. The voice actor profile is on Yukana, specifically about her role in Code Geass. Once again, speaking much more of Clamp. Featured cosplayer this edition is sporting this lovely Yuko Ichihara cosplay. March 3rd, 2005. You can see this one's in pretty rough shape. I'm glad I got it cheap. The feature story is more actually on the Studio B train itself. There is a little on Madlax, but it's a lot more about the studio and the founder. I've actually read this one long before. It's a bit of a favorite among us fans. I think I've even cited it a few times in various videos I've done. Firstly, I love this blurb at the top. It really spoke to the studio's mission. On the side here, we actually have a profile of the director and founder, Koichi Mashimo. This quote really stands out to me. I don't remake. You only get one chance to perform an operation. If only Disney felt that way. There's some great detail about making Dothack and how relentless it was. And from there it goes into the process of making Noir and Madlax, mostly about the common thread of girls of guns and storylines and how their respective creators feel about that. Now over on the far side of this page is a profile on the character designer Satoshi Osawa. Whatever happened to him anyway? After Dothack Roots, he sort of disappeared from the anime scene. Did he die? Did he quit? Did he become a pastry chef like in Shirobako? Who knows? There's never been any news on him. The article continues talking about the nature of business and the art versus commerce side of things. I think what gets me is this prediction of Mashimo in terms of the future, both for Hollywood movies and animation. I think he is right on the money here. It very much is two camps, one of market research and the other placing high effort on the creative staff. There's also this bit about the relationship Mashimo built with Yuki Kajura after Eat Man and Noir before it. Very similar now to how UFO Table's always grabbing her for their shows today. Oh god, there's that pesky studio again, I never know how to say it. Well, moving on further in the magazine, here's another spot on Fullmetal Alchemist. This one actually features a lot of comments from the cast members. Aw, cat girls! Here's some more Eureka 7. The Ring 2? Why is that here? I know the Ring franchise originates in Japan and all, but it's still weird to talk about an American remake of a Japanese horror film in a magazine focused on anime and manga. Wait, Jonathan Clements. I know that name. Oh, that's right, he wrote this book. Oh, here's a real thinker. Is there still room for the classics? I think that's important to think about. Nowadays, as we get the latest shows right away, it's kind of easy to overlook shows from long past. Ichigo Mashimaru. Oh, you thought cute girls doing cute things was a new trend because of K-On? Well, you're wrong. For the DVD charts, the hot seller is Aladdin Special Edition. Okay, now that makes more sense than Shrek to me. August 8, 2003. Cover story is Sakura Wars. Manga insert, Fullmetal Panic. Well, unfortunately, again, the Sakura Wars story is your basic cover story synopsis. It's nothing fancy. Kind of a shame. I think the Sakura Wars anime is really underrated and underappreciated. I like this little chronology here, though, that actually gives the years where it's set. Pretty nice. The behind-the-scenes feature is on Studio Madhouse. Well, it's a general rundown of the studio's history. For instance, did you know Madhouse mostly started out as a theatrical film producer? It was only by the 80s they began to work in TV production. This also gets into the studio's history with the manga group Clamp. Enter the Animatrix, a spot on their contributions for that anime anthology video. According to Kawajiri, it sounded like they had a lot of creative freedom working on that. Sounds nice. This one's also interesting to me. It's Masuda quoting something Satoshi Kon said, that American animation studios are full of staff you don't need. It's a foregone conclusion that if they made the same thing, the American version will cost more. Really fascinating, and I'll admit I really don't know a great deal about the late director. Granted, these are quotes coming out secondhand, but I think it's pretty interesting insight nonetheless. It also mentions the decline of Hollywood 2D animation in terms of box office returns. Truly a sign of the times, the CGI animation from the likes of Pixar was really starting to take over by this point. Masuda predicts it as so, but I'd hardly call it a prediction. I think the writing was clear on the walls that 3D was taking over. Now that's the Madhouse feature in a nutshell right there, so let's move on. I haven't seen the TV series of ROD. I'm only familiar with the OVA, but I gotta say, it looks night and day just based on this. The OVA was like a violent action film. This? Well, I don't know what this is. Oh hey, Kaleidostar. Did you know ADV Films helped produce this? DVD sales. You just can't beat Disney, can ya? Sleeping Beauty is the top seller. Here we have CD albums. Seesaw's Dreamfield is number 2. Go Seesaw. Wolf's Rain OST by Yoko Kanno comes in at number 10. Well, not too bad. On the reader polls, oh, this time Kiri Yamato's the popular main character, with Atherin at number 2. Oh, here again, my Gundam Seed gals rank numbers 2 through 3. Rei Ayanami's at number 5 this time, and Asuka's at 9. Most popular anime? No surprise, Seed at number 1. But hey, Dot Hack is number 7, that's awesome. It even topped Wolf's Rain and Big O. December 2nd, 2002. Here's another feature on Dot Hack, mostly signed, but it also talks a bit about the upcoming Legend of the Twilight. This article actually features interviews with director Koichi Mashimo, producer Daisuke Uchiyama, and Tatsuya Hamazaki, the author of Legend of the Twilight, and later co-writer for Dot Hack GU. Seems to touch on a few topics, mostly with the Liminality OVA. It's interesting. Michiko Yokode is mentioned as a co-writer, but I've only known Kazunori Ito to be the writer of Liminality. Yuki Kajura, the man behind the music of Dot Hack. How truly little we knew back then. Hey, here's a poster for Phantasy Star Online, specifically the version that had episodes 1 and 2. So I presume it's the GameCube edition. Here's another poster for Ai Yori Yaoshi. Flipping forward a bit, here's a spot on Habune Remne. I like this one, it actually goes in a bit more detail of how to understand the world of it. I watched the show a long time ago, but I think a lot of it just flew over my head. No pun intended. Up next we have Galaxy Angel. You know, this one's been sitting on my shelf for a long time, and I think it's time to finally sit down and watch it already. Hit a 10. Yeah, that's my jam. Of course we can't forget the hit Fooly Cooly. What was it about Fooly Cooly that became such a hit over here? I really don't know. As for the article, it has some notes from the Japanese voice cast, pretty basic. Well, of course, it's December, so naturally they have something for the season. This article seems to be all about Christmas-themed episodes and a handful of shows. Here's one on Cardcaptor Sakura, mentioning the differences between the unaltered original and the dub. I do remember I was reading a lot of it about that this time, as Cardcaptors was really struggling to find its footing here in the US. It probably fared a bit better in Canada, probably because they didn't skip every other episode. After that is a preview for Witch Hunter Robin. It has some nice looking production sketches. Granted, they're tiny, but they're interesting. But here's something truly unique. It's an interview with Hiromasa Ogura, who is actually an art director. It's mostly in regards to Fooly Cooly and his work on the show, but I really admire them for taking time to talk with an art director. It's great to see someone take a little time to talk with another link in the chain besides the usual people. Here's a couple more interviews. Shinichi Suzuki and director Mahiro Maeda. Well, these aren't so much interviews. I think they're more like op-eds, but about what? I'm really not sure. Just seems to be whatever they want to talk about, I guess. Maeda, for example, says he hates TV dramas. Okay, I guess that's good to know. Hey, you want to send some postcards to your friends and relatives? How about some Fooly Cooly cards? I have no idea what this is. For the Barrel, Original Edition 2002-2003. Is it a short story? Is it an excerpt for a screenplay? Wait, inspired by a novel. Okay, so it's a novel excerpt. But wait, why does it repeat on the other page? Yes, it's the exact same text on the other page. How did they make a mistake like this? I guess you can be forgiven, it's an early edition, but still, it's a professionally made magazine. It's not like somebody's amateur operation. Official art of Fruits Basket. It also seems to be a relationship breakdown between every character, or at least the characters that we knew at the time. There's also little blurbs by the character designer. I would love to see her in a frilly dress. Oh, fear not. You'll get a chance soon enough. Here's a fun fact about Yuki. Apparently the designs of his kimono were painted on with CGI. Wow, a lot of effort for back then. Some of the designs here aren't fully finished. I wonder if that's because they hadn't finalized the color palette. Wait, what? So when you think about it, Hatsuharu has to have udders too? Hell? Oh, here's Tokyo Mew Mew. Interesting, it would still be a few years before the manga and anime would make it over to the US. And even then, the anime was clumsily handled by 4Kids. Let's jump ahead to the year December 12, 2003. We have yet another spot on .hack. Less behind the scenes, more of an in-depth breakdown of the franchise at that point. Rather like my own video. After that, we got the studio spot on Toei Animation. Much like the Inside B-Train feature, it talked a lot about Toei. It's a nice big look at the studio as a whole, with a lot of great information. Though I gotta say, they kinda overdid it with all the Dragon Ball shots. I mean, come on, Toei has other shows to their name too, you know. Another big feature of this issue is the Tokyo Godfathers spot. It's really about the film's New York premiere, which apparently was held in the basement of a Virgin megastore. God damn, times have changed, haven't they? Actually, it's pretty amusing in a roundabout way. After all, I picked up my first issue of Newtype at a Virgin store. The article doesn't stop there. The next page goes a lot more into Colin's other work. I have to imagine those who were fans of his back then and read this, they must have been delighted to see such an in-depth breakdown of his whole filmography. It's really an impressive tribute. Okay, now this is even more perplexing than the small ad for The Ring 2. We have a whole feature on Lord of the Rings. Look, I'm certain there's plenty of overlap of anime fans and fans of fantasy literature, but this still blows my mind to see this in a magazine dedicated to anime and manga. Especially considering the pictures are all from the live-action Return of the King. Now, it does go into some history of adaptations, including the Rankin Bass version in the 70s, which I know was animated by a lot of Japanese animators who, of course, went on to prominence, including many members of Topcraft who later formed Studio Ghibli. I guess on some level it kind of connects it to the whole anime manga sphere, but I don't know, it's still kind of a weird contrast, especially again, all the pictures being sourced from Jackson's Return of the King. Next up, we have a section called Newtype Express. Seems to be a lot of short blurbs about various projects. This one's on the third of Inuyasha movie. This one mentions some extra episodes of Wolf's Rain, so OVAs, I presume. Anime OVA adaptation from the game by Sakura Wars creator Oji Hiyori, with character designs by Rumiko Takahashi. Well, the manga centerfold yet again is Angel Dust Neo. Tis the season for Sexy Santa with Ayori Aoshi again. A preview for Fullmetal Panic Fumufu. I only ever saw one episode of this anime and I didn't get into it, but tell me this. is the original FMP meant to be like a fictional story within the universe? That's what this article seems to be getting at anyway. Our first preview of Fullmetal Alchemist. Oh yeah, that would have been about the time this anime hit the air, wouldn't it? Oh, here's a preview for Scrap Princess. And an interview with an aardvark? What the actual fuck? I tell ya, early editions can be weird like this. You never know what you're really gonna get. So I guess this was another long-running comic known as Aardvark, which apparently was coming to an end at this point. Ugh, god, again, why is this in a magazine meant for Japanese manga and anime? More Fruba postcards. Oh hey, no more Christmas cosplay, that's cute. Oh, talk about timing, here's a review of Angelic Lair. Well, at the end, we have some game suggestions for all the major platforms at the time. PC, GameCube, PS2, Xbox, and of course we have a gadget buying guide. An N-Gage? Did anybody actually buy that? I don't think so. Highlights of Tokyo Game Show 2003. Fuck, why is there someone dressed up as a polar bear? Then again, why do I always see the same T-Rex at every con I go to? More and more, this magazine continues to perplex me. But I love this big ad for Dot Hack Quarantine. It's a nice way to end this edition. April 2004. This one, we have another studio spot. Inside J.C.Staff. Compared to the Toei article, this one does a better job of showing the variety of shows. But here's the real coup de grace for me, the feature making of Azumanga Daioh, another one of my all-time favorite shows. And it sounds like from the director's comments, they really enjoyed making it and had some fun with it. That's always a good sign for a good comedy. Here's a big ad spot for Final Fantasy XI and Sony's new 40GB HDD for the PS2. Man, the mid-2000s were truly an exciting time for gaming. Oh, here's Galaxy Angel again. Here's another fan favorite. Paranoia Agent, speaking more of Satoshi Kon. Oh, this is unique. The ad here is actually inverted with different content when you flip it over. Oh, here's a spot on Girls Bravo if you need your fan service fix. Flipping ahead some more, here's a story on Makoto Shinkai's The Place Promised in Early Days. This would have been the time Shinkai was really rising to prominence as a filmmaker. Oh, here's a real think piece. What if Clamp manga were made into live-action film? I don't know, some of their stories might actually work, but I don't want to encourage it. This one actually was authored by the Clamp artist Satsuki Igarashi. Apparently, the women sometimes would even get intoxicated and talk about hypothetical adaptations of their work. Wouldn't be the first time an intoxicated brainstorming session led to something weird. Actually, I'm kind of surprised that it hasn't happened yet, at least in Japan. Oh, Tsukihime. Did you know that game is getting a remake? Frankly, I wouldn't be surprised if the anime also gets remade. Probably it'll go to UFO Unlimited Budget Works Studio, let's just call them that. Oh, Appleseed. I know this franchise has a pretty good cult following to it, but I've never seen it. Wait. The world's first true 3D anime? I'm not so sure what their criteria is, but I'm pretty sure Final Fantasy The Spirits Within would be the first. That movie came out 2 to 3 years prior to this. SD Gundam Force. It looks like they made it with motion capture. Pretty impressive for what was still emerging technology at the time. Honestly, I think it was Lord of the Rings that really popularized it. Well, speaking of live-action adaptations, here's one for Kashern's live-action film. In some manga news, this one discusses Del Rey Publishing striking up a deal to release Kodansha properties. So now you can read the classics of Gundam Seed, Nejima, XXXHolic, and Tsubasa Chronicle. Now these days, of course, Kodansha has its own publishing branch here in the US, but it was a different time then. You had more licensing companies. These days, it seems publishers are just cutting out the middleman and doing it themselves. Pre-tier. That's another anime I looked at back in the day. I recall it being another moody magical girl anime, kind of similar to Princess Tutu. But that's memory, so don't get mad if I'm remembering it wrong and you really love it. I don't really remember much about it. Letters to the editor. Now, unlike the previous edition I looked at, this one does have responses. Here's a writer decrying bootlegging. This one is a fan from the UK, a self-described British otaku. Here we have one from Israel. Wow, this magazine really got around, didn't it? I like this one, asking about different gestures we often see in anime, such as the pulling down of the eyelid and sticking your tongue out. Here we have a voice actor spot on Saiko Chiba. This one really focusing on her performances as Maria in Chrono Crusade. Still with her role as Maria, it seems they did the photo shoot of her in a church somewhere. I guess it also makes sense because according to Chiba, she attended a Christian kindergarten. Interesting. Apparently the lyrics in the ending theme, which she also sung by the way, made her uncomfortable. Did you also know that Yuki Kajura wrote the ending theme to Chrono Crusade? It's actually one of my favorite Kajura songs, and one of my favorite anime ends of all time. Oh, here's an interesting fact. April 1967, the first JoJo anime premieres on TV, Ribbon no Kishi, or Princess Knight. Though I guess there is some debate, as the article points out, about if it's Ribbon no Kishi or Mahotsukai Sally, which might be technically considered the first. That really is the trouble when you try to determine any kind of like firsts, especially with something so groundbreaking. There's always some technicality that can hang up the thing. Well, either way, the 60s were certainly the trailblazing decade for anime. Well, we got one more magazine to look at. That's the November 2003 issue. Now, fitting up the heels of my recent review, the cover story is on Angelic Layer. But again, to my chagrin, this is a typical preview feature, not a making of as far as I was hoping. But it is nice to see the property get some love even back then. There's one on Chrono Crusade. It'll go with the stupid spelling that makes it look like Chrono Crusade. But here's something I didn't know until I read this. Apparently there was a short pilot film made before the series debut. The Big O is back! Big O is just one of those shows that I think has a stronger Western following than it does in Japan. I know many cite Bebop as being another example, but I don't think the numbers back that one up. This article goes a bit into the production history of the series, even noting that the environments were very inspired from Batman the Animated Series. Well, it just says Gotham City, but come on, look at Big O and look at Batman the Animated Series and tell me it isn't the same. And here we have a big story on Lupin the Third. It's pretty amazing that after 50 years how popular this franchise remains. Here's an interview with Newtype, Japan's editor-in-chief. He reflected on the first years of the US publication. I love how he mentions so many issues talked about Gundam Seed, even though that show hasn't had its debut in the US at this point. I've noticed that too, with between the features, the blurbs, and just about everywhere, Seed comes up a whole lot of times. This month in anime history, the first commercial VCRs go on sale. Damn, that's not only revolutionary for anime, but for the whole media landscape in general. Here's an interview with Neil Gaiman, which does include how he came to write the English dub script for Princess Mononoke. Apparently Harvey Weinstein, yeah, that Harvey Weinstein, first went to Quentin Tarantino to write it, but Tarantino suggested Gaiman should do it instead. Okay, that would have been something else, having a dub script written by Tarantino. Over here is a Street Fighter comic. Okay. Another short preview on FMA, and of course, the centerfold of Rei Ayanami. It had to happen sooner or later. I'm just surprised it hasn't happened more. Here's an ad for the .hex Sign OST. Wait, Kaishura didn't write for Boogie Pop Phantom? They must be confusing it with Boogie Pop and Others. That is the live-action movie from 2000, not the anime from 2019. Also, it's a bit misleading to cite Blood the Last Vampire. And while yes, she did write for that. More specifically, she wrote for the PS2 game. But I have to imagine that most readers would instantly think of the anime movie instead of the game. I guess that's really a nitpick at the end of the day. After all, Kajura was still quite a newcomer to film and TV composing, and most of her prior work was part of Seesaw, so she kind of was still a relative unknown at this time. I also don't imagine someone would buy the OST to .hack and feel jaded that it's not like Blood. There's really not much more of interest. This issue's kinda dull, to be honest. Here's a review of Castlevania, Lament of Innocence. I haven't heard of this one, but I admit, I'm not as adept to the franchise as others might be. Most of my knowledge comes from the AVGN and that one season of the Netflix series. Anyway, Laments of Innocence seems like it was another attempt to bring the franchise into 3D, but I guess it didn't go over great again. But hey, remember when Konami made games? Yeah, those were the days.
Times have changed, obviously. These days, the internet really is your one-stop shop all for information. Especially among Western fans who've really gravitated away from physical media like old magazines, DVDs, and the like. I mean, things are probably different in Japan. The physical magazine's still in print, as far as I know. Unless it's gone all digital. I actually don't know. But either way, Western fans just don't seem to be interested. And that's why the magazine's gone. But I think going through these really shows you the kind of variety, the diversity of stories and articles. I go on sites like Anime News Network, or those YouTubers I mentioned, it's always the new hotness, it's always the big show that everybody's already talking about. These covered shows really cross the spectrum. Yeah, you saw a few crop up every so often, like Gundam Seed. I got mentioned in, like, just about every issue I own. No denying, there were big titles that kept coming up and coming up. But they also did small ones, too. For that, Newtype was a really special magazine here in the U.S. One that I don't think can ever be really replicated. I'm ShadowBlazer3000. Thanks for watching.